aspect of the Kiyavlavara chant. I emphasize this aspect of returning to tradition, but there is a monastery that is dependent on the Lavra, the Trinity St. Jonah Monastery, Troitsko-Yoninsky Monastery in the Botanical Gardens, and they have several monks that were part of the Lavra Brotherhood in the 90s and then joined this other monastery. And they try to kind of combine a mix of returning to tradition with an emphasis on education, explanation of these chants. And there's a publication that came out in 2004 by Father Dmitry Bolharsky, who was a choir director there and is a priest now, and he teaches in Kyiv at the conservatory and other universities where, for example, they have the notes, the musical notes to sing, and every part of the liturgy is explained, and in the end there's even kind of a mystagogy of the divine liturgy, then a modern Ukrainian transliteration of the Church Slavonic texts of the divine liturgy, and even Bozhe Veliki Yedini for men's choir. So in the early 2000s it was hard to find an arrangement of that, so I'll pass that around as well as a modern adaptation of the tradition of the Lavra with explanation and education. Yeah. So.
We have lots of time for questions, so please.
Yes. You have mentioned the name of the professor of church music at the Ukrainian Catholic University of Lviv. What's his name again?
Yuri Yesenovsky. Yes. He's published several books. He has one general history of Ukrainian church music, particularly focusing on the Irmolohion, so manuscript Irmologia. And I think I'm not sure if the website of the Liturgical Institute, I think it's changed its name recently.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's called now the Institute of Church Music or something like that. So you won't find this website, but it's probably somewhere online on the UKU network, and he has recently published a transcription and a facsimile edition of the suprasil, one of the suprasil Irmologions, Irmologia, that appeared in this new series of the Sources of Kievan Christianity, I think that's what it's called, or Sources of the Kievan Church Tradition, and so his aim is always more historical, and I'm not sure how many people are taking his work and trying to implement it in liturgical practice. There are other clergy and singers at the Ukrainian Catholic University that are, of course, more interested in putting into practice certain aspects of the Irmologion or other church singing traditions, but my impression is that there's sometimes a gap between the historical work in the manuscript studies on the Irmologia and the practical implementation in church life today. But Yesenovsky is the expert, and no matter, even in the Russian Orthodox Pravoslavna Encyclopedia, he's often cited as the foremost authority on many of these questions.
And also, you had mentioned the Basilians. The second time you said the Basilian Press republished the Irmologium later. What year was that?
I think it was in the 50s the first time, because this edition is a reprint. You can oftentimes tell the difference. The original ones, I think, were slightly bigger, if I'm not mistaken. And you can tell also from the binding, this is a North American edition, and they have now been reprinted again, I think, by Svichado in Lviv within the last year. So maybe I'm wrong. Maybe there's the dust is being wiped off these books. But yeah.
So if you were speaking about Western liturgical music, someone might pose the question to someone with a deep knowledge of the tradition like you have and a monastic orientation, isn't it better simply for everyone to return to the original music and the original language? But I know from working with you that you are very keen to see English flourish within the context of our liturgical music. And so how do you reconcile an interest in the purity or authenticity of the sources with a manifest pastoral openness to the use of English, which necessarily changes the music, because whenever you adapt music into another language, you introduce a variable that causes a development to happen, whether organic or inorganic. And how do you see the use of English or French, for example, in Canada, being part of the renewal of our church music tradition? Mm-hmm.
Well, when you're referring to original language and original chant, you mean Greek, right?
Yeah. Yeah. I was going to say, Brian, you and I hang out with very different Latins, because I don't know any Latins who want to get into English.
Yeah, yeah. No. So this is a very good question, and I think it's a necessary question, or it should be the natural outcome of anybody praying somewhere else outside of, for example, praying in a country where the language is different. The problem is complicated for the Ukrainian Greek Catholic Church in particular, because even in Ukraine there's an attempt to restore these traditions, the experience of the underground church, the catacombs, the persecution of the church, and then trying to start everything up from scratch, and then having external forces kind of complicating issues, internal issues that were not resolved before the Second World War, then were then exported into the diaspora. So the idea of adapting the church music tradition to other languages is definitely necessary, but it's somewhat difficult to see what should be the model that one should base on, because if you can't just restore a book and just, ideally you could just take the whole Irmolohion, put it into put it into Finale and then just adapt it to English. In fact, I sent a project proposal for that yesterday. Not specifically for that, but just to digitize this tradition in the sense of having a Finale file or a digital music file where you can have that, even the Church Slavonic text, and then you can give it to people and say, okay, here, you do the Ukrainian version of this, you do the English version. But then, in general, when you have liturgy separate, just kind of done at a desk or on a computer, and or done in individual small parishes, this complicates things, because if you... I don't like canon law, but sometimes it's helpful to cite that the Code of Canons of the Eastern Churches emphasizes this point, that the cathedral is supposed to be the model. So in the example here, both examples here were either a monastery or a brotherhood, so not necessarily a cathedral, but they saw themselves, their duty as preserving this tradition, this particular tradition, which was then at the service of the whole church, so either a monastic tradition or a brotherhood. And so in the Ukrainian Greek Catholic and Greco-Catholic Church, we do not have this brotherhood anymore. The monasteries have other duties. They have a lot of pastoral work. They have to kind of start from scratch. And so they're not necessarily taking the lead on this. The universities are trying to do something, and so they are working on this. But in today's context, it probably should be cathedrals, or if somebody wants to start a monastery or a brotherhood that will do this, then they can do it. But it seems that it would be too simple just to publish a book and put it out there. It will be have the same effect as just having an Irmolohion in Church Slavonic. It needs to be put into practice. There need to be ways to teach this, and it needs to, first, people have to want to do this, and people have to understand that this is continuity of prayer with, if not your parents, then at least your grandparents and everybody before them for a few hundred years, and a desire to understand the depth of this tradition. So I guess the ball is in the court of the hierarchy to kind of take the initiative on this. So if you're watching. Yes. Yeah, sorry. Yes.
We had a question about some of the context surrounding the both the Vyoakeyev from about the 1900s to kind of the rise of the Soviet Union and the suppression of these centers, so like the turn of the century and upwards. So these would be considered high church music centers, preserving the tradition and really being exemplars. What kind of influence did they have outside of their walls? And I ask because I'm reading Cyril Korolevsky's critique of Unitism, and he talked about the aberrations in the liturgy, and he doesn't mention these and anything good about anything associated with liturgical music. So what is your sense of context?
Yeah, and generally in liturgical studies, it's always dangerous to idealize centers and think that everybody else was doing a smaller version of that and everything was perfect. No, definitely not. And even within these monasteries or the brotherhood, everything was not so ideal. Within the brotherhood, there were a lot of fights. I mentioned this turnover of power from one kind of political group to another. And in the monastery, you'll get a lot of stories of not so great things going on, but the influence outside of their respective areas was quite strong. In the Kyiv region, you have the influence of the chants are quite widespread. They're not singing them exactly like this, but the influence of the practice was quite common, and you have pilgrims coming on feast days. There are kind of diaries of certain eyewitnesses that describe how pilgrims would come from as far away as Poltava, would walk to the Lavra for Dormition, and you could tell they were dressed in their finest, you know, Ukrainian embroidery, and they would stand the whole service, even though there were parts of the service where it was encouraged that you'd sit, you know, like during the Kathisma or something like this. So the popular piety connected with these places was very strong. The actual liturgical practice was also influential. At the Lavra, there was no seminary in the early, before the Soviets. The seminary moved there now for the Moscow Patriarchate, but there was a certain contact with people forming clergy, so there was influence there. And people from the city would be involved in, there were the people that initially were responsible for transcribing the music before the monks took over, sometimes were retired generals or engineers that, you know, their hobby was then church music, and they went and transcribed all this stuff. So there was contact there. And in Lviv, I'm not sure about the actual singing practices of the Lviv Brotherhood on other churches, because I've never heard or seen the practice described by Porfiry Bazhansky being imitated or being written down. There is one early or 1950s printing of the Dogmata, the eight Theotokia Dogmatica from Vespers that were published in Rome, that are written out in three-part harmony that seem to follow Bazhansky's explanation or description, but it seems to me that the Staropii had more influence by reprinting the Irmolohion, that any diak in a village church outside of Lviv or in Pennsylvania or in Saskatchewan would, up until probably, I don't know, Second Vatican Council shortly after, would be able to kind of figure out how to use it. And even my grandfather told the story that in their village, they all knew how to sing Ot Yunaste, the From My Youth, this antiphon in tone four that you sing at matins on feast days. That everybody knew it by heart, and they would sing it the way it's written in Irmolohion, and that's the only book that has it written out in Galicia. The Hlasopisnitz doesn't have it, I don't think. So the influence of the printed book was important there, so because it was kind of the only source or the central printing authority in Lviv. Yes?
How many percentage of the people in Ukraine are Catholics?
Now?
Yeah.
I'm told, my sources say 10%, apparently, but there's also...
1% of Roman Catholic.
Yeah, okay, so 1% Roman Catholic, 10% 9% Greco-Catholic, yeah.
And the rest are?
Various things, Orthodox. There's also Jewish and Muslim communities. There's also lots of atheists. There are some Hare Krishna. I don't know. Yeah. Protestants are quite big in certain parts of Ukraine. Apparently, the largest Christian community in Kyiv is Protestant, or was the Embassy Church of God. I don't know if it still exists, but yeah. So Ukraine has always been kind of a multi-confessional country. It has Christian roots and historically Orthodox country, but you have everybody there. Yeah.
Yes. Because you're both a professore and a priest, you have an interesting perspective from the theoretical and the practical. in a regular parish where there's, say, a two masses, say 8:30 is led by a cantor, and even though it's Samuel Cabo, you keep the people happy who want a Samuel Cabo. And in the same parish, there's a 10:30 mass, which has a choir. So you satisfy both camps. Somebody doesn't want to sing through it. But what do you do in a parish where there's only one mass, and yet, and it's recitative without a, it's with a cantor, it's a sung mass, but without a choir. But how do you keep both camps happy with some who might say, but it's too long when we sing? So what aspect would you underline, besides the obvious video chanash and the gospel that should be sung and which should be recited, to keep both camps happy if there's only one mass?
Do you mean recited and sung as in like just said?
Right.
Well, if you listen even to Metropolitan Andrei Sheptytsky explains that the ideal is to sing everything in the tradition. It, you know, there's that popular saying by attributed to St. Augustine, he who sings prays twice. So, you know, then you don't, then you wouldn't have to have those two liturgies. You could have one and still pray. No, I'm joking. But if you're talking about, you know, questions of length, I think that we're going into a slightly different direction with the questions, but if you read Metropolitan's pastoral letter on church singing, and there's a Ukrainian publication, I think, published in Yorkton in the 70s or in Winnipeg, and then there's an English translation published in the book by Father Peter Galadza that's his doctoral thesis on the liturgical and theological work of Metropolitan Andrei Sheptytsky. There's an English translation. I would recommend to read that because he tries to emphasize the importance of uniting both the common participation of everybody and the, let's say, high style or the creative aspect of choral compositions in the same service, and says that anything that the people, that, you know, the deacon says, let us all say with our whole soul, promovmo vsi, zusiei dushi, zusiei misti nashi promovmo, that it should be everybody answering. And so that should be everybody sing. And then there are certain things that are more complicated to sing that require knowledge of the liturgical calendar because they are variable. So for example, the hymn to the Mother of God, Dostoyno, changes, so you could give that to a choir or a group of trained singers. You also have the cherubic hymn, which sometimes has to be longer or shorter depending on if there's a bishop or more clergy or whatever. So he has recommendations for how to do both. But you know, if Ukrainians don't want to sing anymore, then we'll have to change the encyclopedia entry from the Ukrainian encyclopedia. So I would advise people to not even be tempted by recited masses or divine liturgies. To think about what's going on in the worship, that even if you can't sing well, we have the Royal Conservatory of Music here with, I think there's a Timirte and an Ihnatovich hall, so, you know, maybe they can offer like free lessons for church singing for, anyway. But I would encourage one to look in the direction of seeing the benefits of church singing rather than seeing the benefits of getting to, you know, brunch or other activities on Sunday sooner. So, of course, there's the pastoral need. Everybody has to has different conditions in life, but you know.
Still have time for five more minutes for questions.
Yes.
I have a very little addition to your history.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Very.
Maybe
I was
funny,
expecting that.
Maybe,
yeah.
Funny. Maybe funny, but it will be useful for your presentation, for the next presentation.
Funny is always useful.
Yeah. Taras Dmytryk, who was one of the leaders of Brotherhood in '90s, one of the main activists. He now works in Ukrainian Catholic University, so you can add that there is a transition from the Brotherhood to Ukrainian Catholic University.
Well, there you go.
You know.
Yeah.
Yes, he's an Orthodox layman, but he works in Ukraine.
He's a layman. Okay,
yes.
Yeah. Well, there is a publication from the 1990s that is published by the Lviv Stavropihion.
Yeah. He was the head of the Brotherhood for many, many years.
Okay. Yeah, but do you know about a publication There was a publication in English of the published by the Lviv Stavropigion, Passion and Resurrection, by Father Serge Kelleher, where he put Stavropigion as the publisher, but
because
I don't think it exists.
The building that was on the picture, this is not the actual building of the Brotherhood.
No, that's the church. Yeah.
The Brotherhood
inside.
In the yard.
Yeah. You mean the... Yes, this is on the Vulica Ivana Fedorova. In the courtyard you have, those were all the buildings of the Brotherhood, I think, or the Institute. Yeah.
But today, the actual building of the Brotherhood...
Yes, is in the courtyard, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I'm not sure about their activities. Since they're Ukrainian autocephalous Orthodox, they have other issues that they're focused on. Yeah. Yes.
Do you think, and you mentioned the Ukrainian autocephaly at the beginning of your talk, and we will hope to have a session or sessions on this topic. We may not be able to manage that this year, but we'll have hopefully a Tuesday next semester, and perhaps an additional session that will be a panel discussion. But I'm wondering if you think, in the context of contemporary escalation of tensions between churches, is church music a way to, can one speak about a kind of a musical ecumenism, a way in which, and perhaps as Greek Catholics, Greco-Catholics who often are often persona non grata for all sorts of reasons among our Orthodox brethren, is church music a way to build this or live into, lean into the unity that we believe there to be between Eastern Rite Catholics and Orthodox? Can we be leaders in this, or are we destined to be followers?
Well, that's a very interesting question, because you do see the influence of centers like these in the field of church music, and even if you talk about the Moscow Patriarchate within Ukraine, people often think that, it's kind of a branch of just the Moscow Patriarchate in Russia. And you do see, based on the musical tradition, a kind of separation from, let's say, at least the Kyiv region. I'm not sure about all the rest of Ukraine, but a distinction between them and what's going on in Russia because of the influence, for example, of the Kyiv Lavra and singing certain chants that are there, even in parish churches today, I'm talking about. I don't know about so much about the practice 100 years ago. But so you have kind of a line in the sand, so to say, that we sing it this way and we don't sing it that way. And so a way to overcome other barriers by consciously choosing to sing, for example, for the Ukrainian Greek Catholic Church, some chants from the Caves Lavra or something, could be seen as some kind of attempt to show an openness or a desire for some kind of common prayer in the future. I know that some people, for example, this Dmitry Bolharsky, when asked about aspects of Galician chant, he stated that this is your tradition, you should foster that, this is not ours, so we're not going to consciously make an effort to sing your tradition, but we welcome your revival of your own tradition, because they see very often this common background and common heritage that's expressed uniquely today as nevertheless an emphasis on this common heritage and common background. So directly taking something from another church and singing it would be, I guess, a direct sign of some kind of desire or respect for the alternative tradition. I know that even in the Orthodox Church in Ukraine today, there is kind of a trend that things from Western Ukraine are seen as cool, like Lviv is now cool in Kyiv. And so even in Moscow Patriarchate parishes that are more pro-Ukrainian, they will sometimes sing things that are either from the Lviv Irmolohion, or at least it says it is, I'm not sure if it's actually from there, or this Yonafan Yeletskik has done harmonizations of Galician chant that's sung even in the Moscow Patriarchate in Ukraine as, something new, something nice, and I guess it kind of shows looking rather than looking north, sometimes looking more west, even within Ukraine, among Orthodox. Yeah, that's true.
From the Unia Church, yeah. From the Greek Catholic, that's true. Catholic Church, from Basilian monasteries to Kiev-Pechersk Lavra in
1700s
or 18th century.
Yeah, 1700s.
It's very interesting because it also goes contrary to that thesis with their backs to the mountains, you know, because they weren't with their backs to the mountains. They looked to the Kiev-Pechersk Lavra at their traditions.
I think that in that account it was a pilgrimage, but also some kind of investigation to learn about some aspects of certain traditions or something.
And they went to the Kiev Church Lavra to have some books from them.
Exactly. Yeah.
To obtain some books.
And just since you mentioned it, and you add a footnote to me, I'll add a footnote to you that I forgot to mention that even the Staropihil Brotherhood, I'm not sure if Kelly Library has it, but the Pontifical Oriental Institute has the zapiski of, and I'm sure it's in Lviv, the zapiski of the Staropihilny Institute, or their periodical. And it's quite interesting to read their kind of just daily news. They were in contact with Mount Athos and received icons from Mount Athos, like a big icon of the Mother of God or relics. This is at the end of the 19th century. So these, you know, they say the walls that are built on earth do not reach up to heaven, but I think church music or these kind of institutions build little doorways between the walls or kind of tunnels under them sometimes. Yeah.